We must prevent memory errors when we use this library and when we encode the library. So typically errors are double free. So you call free on a malloced pointer several times. This is not allowed. Also, if you lose a pointer that you have forgotten to free, that's a problem because you can never retrieve this pointer anymore. So you basically lose access to the memory location and it's a memory leak. The question here is, who is in charge of the memory? And there are several variants to such a question. In this case, we know that our stack init function basically creates this data structure of the stack. But who is in charge for the values that we push on top of it? Like the individual objects, in this case the strings, or here our integer with 32 bits. Well, that's the user in this case. The user allocates the elements or puts a fixed pointer in, gives them to the ADT, and then the ADT returns it to the user when the ADT calls the pop function, and then the user has to know what it needs to do with the data to free it. The ownership of such an object can be tricky. It's typically API specific. And typically what happens in libraries is that if the user has created an object, the user is in charge of such an object. So the user must ensure that the object is freed properly. A problem is that a library cannot free the structure of an element because an element is unknown, it's just a void pointer. So the library cannot free such elements as it doesn't know the structure. However, what you sometimes see in abstract data types is that you have functions to destroy a stack and destroy a data structure. Here we have a stack destroy function for our stack, but what we support a function, freefunc. You see a void pointer, and this freefunc is provided by the user, and this is then in charge to free the memory. So if this freefunc is given, that's what our implementation does, then we would iterate over our whole stack and call freefunc for each element of the stack elements. And at the end, when we want to destroy the stack, we have to destroy the stack's data structure itself. That's why we call free_s here. And now all the elements should be gone. So how would we use this? Well, in our string example, actually this individual string elements, they lived somewhere in this code segment because they were strings. So we can call stack destroy with null, which means we don't give any function. So it's not, we don't free any of the elements. But for our number example, well, we know we just used malloc to allocate it, so we can call free on those elements. And then all those individual elements would be freed. Cleanup of more complex data structures can be supported by users as they need by passing in a function. Here is a little trick that you sometimes see. It's called stuffing of our data types. We know that an integer 32 has 4 bytes, but our pointer has typically 8 bytes. So that means we could store these 4 bytes into our 8 bytes pointer. And that allows us to get rid of this using the indirection of pointers. Let's try to use this now in our example. So when we push an element, well, we pretend actually to store a pointer. But the value of the pointer, we store the value of the or integer. So we store here value 4, because that's the value we want to store. When we push another element, we just directly store 4711. So in both cases, we have to cast it to a void pointer. And now we don't have our indirection here. We don't have pushed a pointer. We just pushed really values. And now all we need to know is that when we pop something from the stack, we have to cast it back to the appropriate type, so 32-bit data type. And of course, when we destroy the stack, well, we don't pass in anything because the element is just living inside the array and there's no pointer needed that needs to be freed. So now let's discuss our list implementation a little bit. Think about it for a couple of minutes, what complexity the push and pop operations have, and what is the complexity of the support operations like init and destroy. And lastly, think about if there are any limitations of this implementation. So to think about the push and pop operation, we have to go back to their respective implementations, of course, look at this code and think about it in terms of their complexity and time complexity, so runtime. What do you think in terms of big O notation would fulfill those two functions? Once you've done that, go back to the destroy function, have a look there as well. And now pause the video, please, before I reveal an answer. Right, so the worst case complexity of the operations is important, and we know that we can bind push and pop with O of 1 because there is no loop inside, it's just some sequential code that's executed. Also, the init function is O of 1, but destroy is O of n, where n is the number of elements that are still stored in the stack if you pass in a destroy function. Limitations of this implementation is that you have to specify the number of elements that are stored in this array. That's not necessarily a problem because in many cases the stack size for any program is fixed, limited anyway. And we could, however, want to improve the implementation by allowing flexible size, and therefore we could use malloc. And we do remember that malloc, even if you malloc something like 10 gigabytes, it's in fact not physically requested as long as you don't write any data to it. Right, so we could allocate a large array and then fill it as needed. This would allow us to increase the size significantly while not wasting much memory.